Good morning, church. How y'all doing? All right. If you're visiting us for the first time today, in the seat back pocket in front of you, there's a little yellow card. It's our visitor card, if you wouldn't mind filling that out and put that in the collection plate as it goes by this morning. You can also place prayer requests in there. And I think that's all that we're going to collect, kind of data gathering from you in the course of this service. My own announcement today is, if you're the class of 2025, and I see some of the class of 2025 in here, that's the leadership of our church, that the new committee members that are now part of our committee and the leadership of our church, because it turned 1 January a few weeks ago, and now you're going to actually get some training. So please come to Cox Conference Room. I know that Paula has contacted all of you. So if you're wondering whether it's you, if you didn't get a call from Paula, it's not you. Okay. If you got a call from Paula, come hungry, because I think I ordered enough chow. So that's going to happen immediately after this service. Are there any other announcements we need to make in the life of the church? Oh, yes. Thank you very much. Next Sunday, fifth Sunday, we actually get to meet as a church, a one church family. We're going to have one service. We do that every time there's a month with a fifth Sunday. And so we'll just be one service at 10:30, and then it'll be followed by a covered dish dinner. And yeah, and everyone's invited and encouraged. Please come. And remember, the one sentence you can't say is, "Who are you?" It's one of those things. That's what happens sometimes when an 8 o'clock service person shows up at the 11 o'clock. People treat them like they just got saved. They've been coming to church for 50 years and just, yeah. So anyhow, that's part of the reason, the method to our madness, why we at least a couple times a year gather as one church and say, "Oh, I didn't know you were part of the church. I was here while you were still in diapers." But anyhow, enough commercial. Let's pray. Come, O Lord, come in among us. We're going to leave the world outside, Lord, for an hour. We're going to purpose that this is your hour. If we can't give you any other time today, we give you right now. And for the rest of our gathering here, it is yours. We will allow you to do what you always do. You keep the planet spinning, and we act like somehow you need our help. No, but you ask us, you employ us, or you implore us to worship you, for you are worthy. And we do that today through song, through prayer, through being still in your house, just acknowledging that you are God and we are not. That's our intention today, and we place it on the altar. May it be a sweet fragrance to you, O Lord. We ask this in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. Well, we are blessed today. We get a privilege of baptizing a baby. Woohoo! And some of you may know that when I was in the military, I used to jump out of perfectly good airplanes. Of course, if you've been in the military, you know there is no such thing as a perfectly good airplane in the military, but that's a whole nother story. And that's not half as scary as baptizing a baby. So if I could invite the Jeffcoats down, they're worried. I'm like, "You got the easy part. This is your child. I got to have that baby potentially cry while I'm holding it," which goes to prove what many people have suspected all along, that the pastor's a meanie. So sponsors come up too. All right. Let's see. Oh, are we ahead of Jim's schedule? Is he not back? Oh, there he is. Man, yeah, hey. I'm here for a long time. Yeah. I didn't see you. I wasn't looking behind me. That's, you know, and since I just heard that briefing on an aircraft, you know, where they said, "And the nearest exit may be behind you." I'll keep that in mind. Okay. So on behalf, we lost a pacifier there. Is there, how many second rule is it when you're in church? Yeah, okay. Yeah, don't worry. You got the easy part. On behalf of the whole church, I ask you, and this is to parents and godparents both. On behalf of the whole church, I ask you, do you renounce the spiritual forces of wickedness, reject the evil powers of the world, and repent of your sin? Do you accept the freedom and power God gives you to resist evil, injustice, and oppression in whatever forms they present themselves? Do you confess Jesus Christ as your Savior, put your whole trust in His grace, and promise to serve Him as your Lord, in union with the church which Christ has opened to people of all ages, nations, and races? Do you do this? Yes. Amen. Okay, now, godparents, will you nurture young Caitlin here in Christ's holy church, that by your teaching and by your example, she may be guided to accept God's grace for herself, to profess her faith openly, and to lead a Christian life? Will you do this for Caitlin?
We will.
Okay, in that case, now, congregation, you got a question here. And actually, I should have had you turn to page 35 already, so I'll give you time. Madly turn to page 35. You have to do it with frenetic energy. And whenever you make this kind of a promise, you ought to be standing if you're able. So please stand up. So I ask you, gathered here, do you, as Christ's body, the church, reaffirm both your rejection of sin and your commitment to Christ? Will you nurture one another in Christian faith and life and include Caitlin now, who is before you, into your care? Let us say together, with God's help, we will proclaim the good news and live according to the example of Christ. We will surround Caitlin with a community of love and forgiveness that she may grow in her trust of God and be found faithful in her service to others. We will pray for her that she will be a true disciple and will walk in the way that leads to life. Okay, church, you may be seated. May I have young Caitlin? Okay, Caitlin, this will be over soon, okay? Caitlin Josephine Jeffcoat, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Receive these gifts from God. Amen. Oop. Yeah, she's given me the eyes. I've seen Glenda look at me that way before. Through baptism, Caitlin, you are incorporated by the Holy Spirit into God's new creation and made to share in Christ's royal priesthood. We are all one in Christ Jesus, and with joy and thanksgiving, we welcome you as a member of the family of Christ. God bless you. Okay, y'all may be seated. Thanks.
Morning, church. If you are able, please let's stand and sing 467, Trust and Obey.
Thank you.
Let's affirm our faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended to the dead. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended to heaven and seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated.
Would the ushers please come forward? Let us pray. Lord, why would you need gifts from us? You created everything. Well, Lord, we know it's because we're the ones who need to give, that as we give, we show faith. We show trust, not just in you, but in the body of Christ, that you purpose the body of Christ to be your hands and feet into the world. And for that, we place these gifts. May they be used to advance your kingdom, advance the gospel, to show love and mercy to our brother man. We ask these things, Lord Jesus, in your mighty name. Amen.
Please be seated. Now it's time to young disciples.
Go camping, and guess what? I want to take y'all with me. Now I gotta ask for time off from work, so I'm not sure when they'll let me off. So not sure when it'll be, but it might be short notice. But y'all need to be ready, okay? Everybody know how to make a fire, like set up your tent, go fishing, find some, huh? You know how to do a lot of that? Okay. You know how to fish. Okay, that's good. Awesome. Okay, so while y'all are waiting for me to call you and give you the go-ahead, I want you to start getting ready. If you don't know how to put up a tent, maybe start practicing in the backyard. Get you a tent and start trying to put it up. And if you don't know how to put a worm on a hook, get Dad to help you try to figure that out and build a fire. That's really important because we got to eat, right? You know how to make a s'more. I bet you know how to make a s'more, right? Okay. So, but y'all got to be ready because when I'm ready to go, it's like I'm ready to go, okay? I'm not waiting around. If you're not ready, if you don't know how to build a fire, I don't know if I want to take you because I need people that know what they're doing when I go camping. I learn how to swim, too, because we're going to have a river. Okay? All right. Just like getting ready to go camping, guess what? Jesus said, when he was fixing to leave, he said, I will be back, and you need to be ready, because you're not going to know when I'm coming. I'm going to be like a thief in the night. No one knows the day or the time when Jesus is coming back, but he wants us to be ready. How can we get ready for Jesus? Raise your hand if you know one way we can get ready. What about... Just doing the thing you need to do. What's something we need to do? That was a good answer. What about, should we be kind to people? Start practicing being kind? Should we love other people? What's one of the big rules in the Bible? Love your neighbor, right? As yourself? Okay. What about praying? Do we need to pray? Practice praying? You know, sometimes when I go camping, I make a list of all the things that I need to do. Maybe you know what our list is for getting ready for Jesus? The Bible. The Bible tells us everything we need to know to get ready. You have a new what? Book? Oh, okay. Is it a Bible? So y'all get into your Bibles. And maybe mom and dad can help. If you want to know something, it's in there. If you want to know, let's see, what's something you want to know? How to pray? How do we pray? He taught us how to pray. Our Father who art in heaven, right? And he tells us how to help. He tells us to take care of people. So I want y'all, now, okay, disclaimer, I'm not really going to take y'all camping, okay? That was just to set an example of what I was talking about, but you do need to get ready for Jesus, because guess what? He could come before lunch. He could come in 10 years. So in the meantime, we need to be ready. We need to pray. We need to love other people. We need to read our Bible so we know what to do. And we need to pray. Very good. All right, let's pray. Repeat after me. Dear Jesus, we love you so much. We can't wait to see you again. Please help us to be ready. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Genesis 3:22-24. And the Lord God said, "The man has now become like one of us, knowing good and evil. He must not be allowed to reach out his hand and take also from the tree of life and eat and live forever." So the Lord God banished him from the Garden of Eden to work the ground from which he had been taken. After he had drove the man out, he placed on the east side of the Garden of Eden cherubim and a flaming sword flashing back and forth to guard the way to the tree of life. Revelation 2:3-7. You have persevered and have endured hardships for my name and have not grown weary. Yet I hold this against you. You have forsaken the love you had at first. Consider how far you have fallen. Repent and do the things you did at first. If you do not repent, I will come to you and remove your lampstand from its place. But you have this in your favor. You hate the practices of the Nicolaitans, which I also hate. Whoever has ears, let them hear what the Spirit says to the churches. So the one who is victorious, I will give the right to eat from the tree of life, which is in the paradise of God. This is the word of God. Thanks be to God. Amen.
I've got to say, I was wondering how many repairs they were going to need in the sprinkler systems as the kids were in the backyard driving in tent pegs and driving it through all the sprinkler lines in their backyard. Yes, that's where my mind goes to sometimes. The sermon title today is GOAT. I'm figuring that many of you are young enough that you may even use this term in your daily walk. I don't. But I finally got to where I don't have to look it up anymore. What's it stand for, church? Greatest of all times. I can't believe how long it took me to figure that out. It's terrible. Thank God for Google. I had to Google it. And then I still would see it and say, what does that mean again? And especially, they use it around sports all the time. You know, the greatest of all times. That just basically means that you don't remember people like Mickey Mantle and things like that. But that's a whole other story. The one thing about greatest of all times is there's an aspect of individuality that there should be, but I'm going to have to purge that part from this message. But what do people that are the greatest get, right? They get the greatest prize. They get the real thing worth having. That's the part of GOAT for this morning's message. Not that when this is all over, someone in this congregation is going to be the goat. Because we know there's only one goat, right? Jesus. So, go ahead and relax. You can't be that kind of goat. But what you can get, and I sometimes need this reminder, so as they taught me in seminary, if you're not preaching to yourself sometimes, trust me, the congregation's not going to be interested, is to remember, you know, the goat doesn't get a prize. The goat gets the prize, right? Gets the thing above all things. And that is what the church in Ephesus was being told they get if they're victors, if they win, if they cross the finish line. And then, you know, that's why the next phrase says, hear what the Spirit is saying to the churches, plural. It wasn't just a message for a church that existed back when God inspired somebody to write them a letter and say, do these things. It's to the churches. Listen to the Spirit. And I think we need to as the church. Sometimes we think that we're living in different days than we're back then. I hope you don't think that. Everything we struggle with in the church has been struggled with before. And the Bible says as much. There's nothing new under the sun. Everything has happened before. If you know, during the week we met to have our final, well, I guess it was last Sunday, but it was anything that happens after church, I consider next week or into the week. But we met and we were given a sermon from Wesley. We weren't given all of it, by the way. Okay, this is me doing the rebuttal. I thought it would be rude while the DS was still here. But we weren't given all of it. But it made it sound like the church only recently has had to be aware, you know, on guard, trying to decide what is true and what is false. If you read Revelations 2, that verse, the church in Ephesus, man, they were good at it. They said, you know, God commends them, said, you're able to tell a false apostle. You can tell when someone's using my name, but they don't know who I am. This need for the church to have discernment is as old as the church. And it's part and parcel of every church that God gives a lampstand. In other words, makes it worthy for the rest of the body of Christ to pay attention to. It is part of doing church. So we're going to have to be discerning what's real and what's not. What kind of things besides the current fight could we get distracted by or could somebody run with? Well, in Ephesus, the primary rival church, do we have a Calvary Chapel in Uvalde? No, okay, we don't have any branch of that. In New Mexico, almost every city has a branch of Calvary Chapel. Calvary, I gotta say it right, it's not horses. It's Calvary, which is the hill, like a skull. That's what Calvary is, the skull hill. Anyhow, it's a very common franchise in New Mexico. And I'm not condemning all of them because they have almost no quality control. You don't have, you know, they don't have a way of determining who's a pastor and what. If you get people to come, lots of people to come, people say, Calvary Chapel, let's go there. And they pride themselves on being better than any of the denominational churches. In fact, they have artwork in Calvary Chapel, Albuquerque, where it shows the other denominations are represented like tanks shooting at each other, and they're above the fray. But they tend to... They're a success church. Let's just put it that way. I don't mean to cast aspersions on all of them because some of them are legit. But in some of them, the reason why they have the numbers they have is because they have a Nicolaitan gospel. And what is a Nicolaitan gospel? It comes from the word for victory. You come here, you ascribe to our doctrine, and you will be victorious. Through faith, you will get everything promised to people who have God's favor. And I don't want to disparage that. I'm a big believer in, if God said it's in the book, potentially it's yours. And the potential has nothing to do with you being worthy of it, has nothing to do with you being good enough for it. In fact, God gives things to me all the time when I'm not being good. But it has everything to do with who God is. He's a loving Father. So you can go to the bank with those promises, but if you think that God's a genie that's going to pop up and grant you wishes, if that's the gospel, then you're part of the Nicolaitan church. If you think he's at your beck and call, this is part of the teaching of the Nicolaitans. And it's in the 21st century, but it was in the first century. And Ephesus is able to withstand that and say, and God says, thank you that you didn't fall in with the Nicolaitans. Thank you for not getting in the prosperity gospel or whatever it's called, because it has a lot of different forms. It's not just a single denomination. It's any time we make God a genie, that's part of the Nicolaitans. And the Ephesians were good, and they could recognize it and said, good. They even persevered when it wasn't easy. You know, it's not always easy to take a difficult position in a time of cultural change, like we're having to do now. We said, we realize people sometimes get offended if we say this thing. But it's in the Bible, so we got to persevere, right? They persevered. So what could God possibly be saying to them that would resonate in Uvalde today? For all of their doctrinal correctness, biblical correctness, whatever you want to say, whatever their level of education, that they could even know. In Genesis 3 today, he said he put cherubim. You might even know that the singular is cherub. And you might have been to Sunday school and learned that every time you see im on a Hebrew word, that's an S. So you might know there wasn't just one cherub at the garden, at the edge of the garden. There were plural, cherubim. Man, you're good. So you can be educated beyond your intelligence. And remember, that was the sin that got Adam and Eve kicked out of the garden. We heard in Genesis 3 that they had the choice between two trees, and they chose knowledge over life. They chose the knowledge. What was the promise with knowledge? You shall be as God. In other words, knowledge will rival your relationship with God. And haven't I just gone on for the start of this sermon that I was talking about how they were able to determine all of these things? They knew all of these facts. So you're like, what are we to do, preacher? Does that mean we shouldn't listen to your sermons? Probably sometimes. But it's to draw the right lesson. What the Spirit is saying to the churches and speaking to Ephesus, it was saying, knowledge isn't what God is after. He says, you've forgotten what it was like when you first loved me. When you first, you know, think about those giddy days of, if you can, I don't know, for some of you it's going to be a puppy. For others of you, you're still sitting next to that person now 50, 60 years on. Whatever your epitome, some of you, it's unrequited love. You can still remember it was that boy or girl back in high school or whatever in your homeroom. Go there and say, do I still get those same butterflies in my stomach for Jesus as I did when I first became a believer? Because for all the good things that Ephesus was doing, for keeping the church doctrinally correct, God says, but I have this thing against you. You forgot it's about me. You forgot it's about me. I'm going to use an example now for myself that may or may not work for you, but I think it works in Uvalde, that's why I'm bringing it here and preaching it here. You sometimes feel you have to be guarded when you go somewhere and you whip out your, you know, I talk about this, the Uvalde driver's license or whatever it is that reveals that you are a Uvaldean or however one conjugates Uvalde. Even if you never leave Uvalde, have you had people say, hey, what was going on with your cops? Or what was going on in your city council or whatever they've seen in the news and all of a sudden you're defensive. And prior to May 24th, you weren't defensive. Prior to May 24th, you were like, man, I am proud of this town. It's growing. And you were naming good things. But now you're on the defense. Well, I'm that way in a lot of things in my life. I didn't need to move to Uvalde to be guarded. Some of you have tried to hug me, right? No laughing? Okay. I was going to say, I know who's still trying to get me to hug. I'm guarded. And I show it in my body language. I had a buddy who says, you're like a hand grenade with the pin pulled. You know, people pick that up real easy. Jesus is saying to us, you know, you've become guarded towards me. I've been telling this example in the two previous messages, so I'll tell it now. And I hope that I'm able to convey that sense of just really letting your guard down. So I know you know I've been to war a few times. In one of those deployments, I was with an infantry unit in Iraq, and and the war was kinetic. Things were going boom. And by that point, the war had been going on long enough that we had adapted to the enemy. We knew that one of the things that was going to kill us, even if we survived the blast of an explosion, and everywhere we traveled in vehicles, so they were always trying to blow us up. And we learned through, unfortunately, through injuries, that sometimes you can survive the blast and still die. And that's because, thank you, Iran, they taught the rebels how to punch holes in our armored vehicles. And in that flash, that surge of heat, you would get so badly burned that you'd survive the blast, and then a few weeks later, because 60% of your body was burned, you would die of infection. So we all wore, from our toes to the top of our head, Nomex. They were basically the same racing suits that Formula One wears, because Formula One has the same problem, fire. So we were dressed like Formula One race car drivers, to include our gloves. We got to wear pilot's gloves. Pilots dress this way all the time, because pilots have the same problem with fire. But we went, well, just like Formula One, the only thing that we couldn't cover was our eyes. So we had, you know, pulled on a headpiece. We had bodysuits. We put on bulletproof glasses, or bulletproof if the bullet was going slow enough, not all bullets. Kevlar helmet, body armor. I mean, we were like tanks. And to the Iraqis, we looked about as foreign, we looked as unhuman as humanly possible, because we were all chunky and we moved chunky, and there was no skin showing. You couldn't tell whether it was a black American or a white American or an Asian American. We were covered. And the body armor we had in the early days of the war was these thick, thick ceramic plates. They've gotten a little better now. But by being thick, they were heavy. Can you imagine how hot all of this that I'm describing you is? What you is. You is or is you ain't my baby. Some of you remember that song. Some of you don't. No giggling back there. But anyhow, very, very hot to wear all of this stuff. And we felt we needed to do that to survive. But that's kind of, I spend that time to describe, that's what my soul is all the time, in case you wonder why David Basher doesn't hug. I've got that much armor on all the time. Well, anyhow, as we were going on a particular patrol one time in this village we hadn't been in before, the colonel, who was from that village, he lived in that village just to show us that it was safe. He took the patrol in front of us, and he went in his very dowdy little khaki uniform that didn't have any of the flash protection that we were wearing. He didn't even have socks on. Didn't even bother to clip his shoulder holster. You know, a shoulder holster is nice, but if you don't clip it in, when you go to draw it, you get the holster and the gun with you. So it's not a quick draw thing if you don't clip that thing. He didn't clip that thing. I guess he didn't plan to draw his pistol very fast. And he walked in front of our patrol. And I mean, talk about making us look like fools. To have him out there in front, no socks, no clipped holster, walking just saying, "It is safe, you dumb American." He wasn't saying that. He was being kind. But the body language, it told everybody. And then, of course, we are on, and, you know, everything but fingers on the trigger. You know, we are bodied up, armored up, everything like that. He walked us through the village. Nothing went bang. Nobody shot at us. All of the armor we had proved totally unnecessary. And then we got to his house. And so he lived there all the time to say, that's how safe it is. I can live here and not worry about getting killed. And then we walk in, and he has this amazing feast for us, and we can't even get to our mouth. We can't even drink water the way we're armored up. So he says, you got to take your armor off. Now, I've been to war a few times in the Middle East, and I've never taken my armor off unless I was protected by Americans in a ring of steel, American steel, and all of that. This is the only time in six times at war that, or well, three times with armor, that I took my armor off and sat down and you know, was completely vulnerable to, at the behest of a man that I didn't know. But, you know, it was what was required. the bullets that we brought and the bullets we were willing to put on other people were no good if the people said, they don't love us. They don't love us enough to even eat with us without taking their armor off. This is what Jesus is saying to the church in Ephesus, and maybe to you and I in the church in Uvalde. To say, you've been guarded. Good, good. Be loyal. You be those things. But when it comes to me, you have to put all of that aside. But if you will, if you get back to that first love, I will take you all the way back to Genesis 3. Your first human parents failed because they chose knowledge over life. And once they'd chosen the knowledge of good and evil and set all the wars and cancer and everything in motion because of the choice of that tree, we've been separated from the paradise of God all this time. But now, if we can return to our first love, even that church that promises victory, that's because that's what Nicholas means, victory. The Nicolaitans promised victory, and this is God showing true victory comes when you remember your first love, when you treat God like you used to, or like, even if you've never treated God that way, maybe that's the call to say, treat them like that person that you love. Even unrequited love there. Trust me, God will not be unrequited love. But if we can bring that kind of innocence and unarmoredness or vulnerability, whatever the right understanding is, then God says to you, that makes you victorious. In a sense, that makes us great, the greatest of all time. Because then, and only then in that vulnerability, God says, you will get to eat from that tree that's been waiting for the human race since the human race began. And where do you get to eat it at? You get to eat it in the paradise of God. I guess I'm going to have to take some armor off. Let us pray. Lord, why would you want to eat with us, particularly as we grow hard or calloused, as we grow like we need to protect ourselves when, unless you protect us, we're standing guard for no reason. So, Lord, we will be vulnerable to you. We will bring you flowers, or we will write you love notes, or we will just want to sit in your presence. Whatever we would have done with a human lover, we will do for you. And you have promised us a great thing. We get to do that forever in the paradise of God. It's in your name we pray, Jesus. Amen.
Please, let's stand, if you are able, and let's sing hymn 357, Just As I Am, Without One Plea. Only verses 1, 2, 5, and 6.
Thank you.
Please be seated.
Finding myself at a loss for words, and the funny thing is, it's okay. The last thing I need is to be heard, but to hear what you would say, word of God speak. Pour down like rain, washing my eyes to see your majesty, to be still and know that you're in this place. Please let me stay and rest in your holiness, a word of God speak. Finding myself in the midst of you, beyond the music, beyond the noise, all that I need is to be with you, and in the quiet, hear your voice, word of God speak. You pour down like rain, washing my eyes to see your majesty, to be still and know that you're in this place. Please let me stay and rest in your holiness, word of God speak. You pour down like rain, washing my eyes to see your majesty, to be still and know that you're in this place. Please let me stay and rest in your holiness, a word of God speak. Finding myself at a loss for words, and the funny thing is, it's okay.
And here now the benediction. Lord, you create when you speak. You have spoken over us and made us promises. You honor your promises. Help us to live in them, to walk in them, to allow you to be God, but to know that you love us and you are a loving Father. Let us carry that hope, that good news from this house today. And may it bring glory to your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.